Good morning. I was going to start off this week by giving you a sharp, sharp, succinct commentary on the state of the federal election campaign, as conducted by Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau in Vancouver at week's end, as we say in the business. But I find myself baffled. I can't comment on his particular tactics or techniques because I'm not allowed to use the language he uses. Get off your bleeps, indeed. Fancy that. Really, this is a family television station. But there are some people who say that Mr. Trudeau would be in a much better position to tell people to get off their bleeps if, in fact, he, with his exceedingly distinguished background, had ever dirtied a fingernail at a job in the ordinary course of life, whether carrying a picket sign or no. So let's leave the Trudeau campaign until it develops into issues which involve clean language. Certainly no problem about that with Joe in either English or in French. And this morning, too, I was going to give you another little shot on whose little bribe is this in the provincial election campaign. We all know the bribe in the sunrise-sunset budget from the ebullient Premier Bennett. Vote for me, and I shall give you all these little goodies in the budget. And Barrett has appeared this weekend, too. He's not only going to give us the BC rail to Alaska at God knows what cost, although hopefully the American military will build the railroad to Alaska, but he's going to bring back the year of 1972. Now, how he can do that, short of being the savior himself, is a little bit beyond even my reason. 1979, 78, 77, 76, 75, 74, 73. There it is. It's back 7 years, 1972. And when he brings it back, he's going to bring back the Lord save us all. Community resource boards. I thought he and Levy had learned their lesson on that particular boondoggle, but apparently not. And then he's going to bring us back. He's going to freeze gas and oil prices. Now, that's a very clever thing to do nowadays, and I would wish him well on that. But there's another little bring back he's going to bring us. And the boys on the radio, I do hope they're listening this morning, and the ladies in the radio, keep talking about this issue as if it were to do with the separation of British Columbia from Canada. When former Premier Barrett says he's going to bring back succession duties, he's not bringing back secession duties. Secession means to go away, to split off. Succession means to soak the rich. Anyway, that's my commentary. It means nothing. But as I said to Premier Bennett the other day, this double campaigning is nothing less than horrifying. So to help clear the air on a couple of allied issues this morning, I have two very distinguished guests. One is the former president of Simon Fraser University, if it's still there up on the mountain. I'm not quite sure whether or not the librarians have taken it all away. Is Pauline Jewett, and she and I are going to have a little barney together. And then, as a special bonus to start this week with brilliance and ebullience and nonsense, the man in the Borsellino. Do you recognize that vacant-looking face? That is Tricky Dicky Beddoes from the Toronto Toad and Flail. Anyway, to get off the ground this morning, then we're going to turn to a federal topic, and it's about extra income tax you pay. Because other people fiddle at least $100 million on a loophole in the Canadian Tax Act, which is big enough to drive $100 million through. And it could be stopped. Brian was out reporting it. Here's what the tax man says about a number of, phony applications for non-dependent relatives overseas. And here's the tax man about to say something.
These are receipts that people would file with a return when they're claiming support of dependents who live outside the country.
Are some of those falsified?
Yes. I don't know how many or which ones, but some of these are false. No money exchanged hands.
And this morning, for your edification, crooked Jack Webster is going to submit a falsified income tax return on the air so that we can all get in on the act after this break. don't normally tell people how to cheat on their income tax, but the racket has become so widespread in Canada that it's quite obvious we're going to have to take the same attitude the United States took and stop this kind of deduction for dependent relatives overseas, which is wide open to fraud of the Canadian taxpayer and the Canadian government in the largest and most flagrant possible way. In my hand, I have your 1978 combined federal and provincial income tax return guidance tables for residents of the country. And under Section 34, you are entitled to deduct from income for the support of resident dependents who did not live in Canada, providing proof of support, to wit, a money order receipt or transmission of money, proof thereof, is made along with your income tax, and you do it on a special form, a T1E-NR. For the sake of simplicity, and please don't add the figures, because they don't all add up to 100%, I'm going to do a little takeoff on it. And the first one you're going to see is Honest Jack's income tax return. That's Honest Jack Webster. Income $25,000, the Lord forbid. Standard deductions, $5,200. Taxable income, $10,700. Taxes to pay, $5,800. That's what the mug pays. He pays his straightforward tax. And then we're going to come to Crooked Jack's special fiddle. That is me, but not really me. And he makes phony claims for fictitious. Fictitious is spelled wrongly. F-I-C-T-I-T-I-O-U-S. Fictitious relatives in Brigadoon. You know Brigadoon, the disappearing Scotch village from the musical. And I'm claiming for each of the following relatives who are alive and well, I certify. Ebenezer Webster, $840 sent to Scotland. Aloysius Webster, $840 sent to Scotland. Egbert Webster, $840. Esther Webster, that was old Auntie Eitzel. Let's see some more. Letitia Webster, $840. And Seamus Webster, $840. And I have receipts attached to my income tax for $5,040, which comes off my taxable income in the following fashion. Here we go. Remember now. Honest Jack had tax to pay of, let's see it, $5,800. Tax to pay of $5,800. Crooked Jack now deducts an extra $5,040 for my phony relatives in Brigadoon. So now, Crooked Jack, instead of paying $5,800, only pays $3,800. And I've cheated the tax department and you, dear fellow citizen, of $2,000. And of course, I've also got the $5,040 that I did not send to relatives as per my money order receipts. Now, there are a number of ways to do this, and I want you to know all the techniques. So I sent my trusty reporter, what is his name again? Brian Coxford, down to the tax department to interview one of the high hegians in charge, just to see the extent of this incredible fiddle. And incredible fiddle it certainly is. Brian and the tax man will now fill you in.
Jack, everybody's out to try and beat the tax man. In fact, at this time of year, they're actually lining up to try and do it. But there's a bit of a situation that not too many people know about. It involves a tax ripoff at the income tax level, supporting dependents overseas. Dependents that perhaps don't even exist, and people are pocketing the money. It involves millions of dollars across this country, about 20 million here in Vancouver.
It's all spelled out under Section 34 of the current tax guide, and it's been going on for years. It's that section that allows us all to support non-resident dependents in foreign countries. But to make the deduction using special form T1ENR, it means a trip to the tax office.
Okay. Excuse me, sir. Could I get a copy of the particular declaration form for non-residents?
T1ENR, sir?
Right.
How many copies would you like, sir?
A couple, please. And I just file that with my normal income tax form.
Yes, you do, sir.
It's one of the most sought-after pieces of paper at the tax department. People who work here refer to it as the non-existent dependent behind the Iron Curtain form. And it contains not one, but four slots per page for dependent deductions. And each year of the tax forms, the allowable deduction per dependent keeps rising. In 1976, we were allowed $720. In 1977, it rose to $780. In 1978, it's $840. It's such a nice, easy deduction that people are ripping off the system.
Mr. Ellerton, those are a sampling of some of the receipts you get with income tax returns.
These are receipts that people would file with a return when they're claiming support of dependents who live outside the country.
Are some of those falsified?
Yes. I don't know how many or which ones, but some of these are false. No money exchanged hands, other than the cost of buying the receipt.
Okay, let's get this straight. Now, a person who's here can support a relative overseas?
Yes, and claim it as a dependent.
On their income tax?
On their income tax.
And some of those are falsified?
And some of them are falsified.
Is this becoming a common thing?
Well, it's common enough to create our interest, because we have found that there are exchanges, we call them, and they call themselves.
These are foreign exchanges.
Foreign exchanges. And this is that will sell these receipts for 3, 5, 7, or 10% of the face value of the receipt, with no other money changing hands. So if you are, if you immigrated to this country, you could go to one of these exchanges when you file your tax return the following year and ask them to get your receipt. And they say, fine, how much do you want it for? I'd like it for $2,000. And I'd like to show it as being sent to my father, my mother, or my brother over in my home country. And the man would say, that's fine, and give me 5% of the face value of the receipt, 5% of the $2,000, and I'll get your receipt. So the $100 changes hands, and the gentleman walks off with a $2,000 receipt.
So in that particular case, he gets the receipt. The foreign exchange gets a surcharge on money that's not even going out of the country.
This is true. Then when he files his tax return, he supports the fact that he's claiming these non-resident relatives by using this receipt.
20, 40, 60, 86, 20, 30, 40, 45.
It's the kind of deduction that involves a lot of money. And to make it tough for the tax department to trace, people supporting or claiming to support non-resident dependents send cash overseas. Or at least that's what the receipts from the fly-by-night foreign exchange merchants indicate. And the forms are the only proof.
Take a situation. Now, I've heard it said that if you take a figure of about $20 million and apply that to the Vancouver office, and this office is by no means the largest in the country, that there's approximately $20 million going out of the country, or supposedly going out of the country, to dependents. Is that a realistic figure?
I believe it. It could be realistic, because we did have a case that we took to court because the people who operated the exchange did not report all of the profits they made by sending this money to the foreign countries, and their business for that particular year was $5 million. They had written $5 million worth of receipts.
One company?
One company. And we have, we know of approximately 20 companies that do this in Vancouver, so it's not impossible to be this figure.
20 million.
20 million, yes.
If we considered that the Vancouver figure is realistically about 20 million, then we're looking at somewhere in the vicinity of 100 million, perhaps more, in the whole country.
I would think it's not impossible, because we have 25 or 26 offices across the country, so I would think that's not impossible.
And that's for 1 year?
For 1 year, yes.
And we would have no way of knowing, unless there was investigations on each individual, as to what proportion of that money is actually going to a relative or into somebody's pocket?
No, we'd have no way. You have to assume that the money did go to the relative.
How can you check individual returns to find out if a person is actually sending this amount of money to an individual relative in some other country?
If we have a treaty with that particular country, we could go to the that country, to the taxing people in that country, and they would investigate for us. But many of these countries we don't have tax treaties with, and therefore it would be all, we couldn't, be impossible.
It sounds like it's impossible, period.
I would say definitely yes, yes. It's too mammoth a job for us to ask the foreign country to do this job. Even if we had a tax treaty, it would certainly eat up their man years.
You need an army of investigators and mountains of paper.
I'm afraid so, yes.
Now, you have a couple of examples where an individual was making several $1 million worth of claims. He's since been charged and fled the country.
Yes, as a matter of fact, the chap that who these receipts belong to, charges have been laid.
Those are his receipts, right?
Those are his copies of the receipts he issued. Charges have been laid, but he has disappeared. The sheriffs are unable to locate him.
Does it involve several $1 million?
I believe he issued about, in this particular year, about $2 million worth of receipts. And I believe there's approximately one-third of them that we can establish. We believe we can establish one-third of them as being false.
Could be more, though.
Oh, yes, there could be more.
And he'd be taking his regular 5% or whatever off the top.
He'd be taking a certain percentage off the top, or
issuing receipts for money that either went out of the country to somebody else or went into somebody's pocket, and he's taking 5%.
Yes, this is true.
Yeah. Another example of a company that didn't report their income?
That particular company did not, to our knowledge, have false receipts, but they didn't report their profits that they made as a result of sending the money to the foreign country.
And there's absolutely no way of checking whether that money actually did get there to relative A or B or...
No. We know it left the country.
Went to somebody.
Went to somebody outside of Canada. Whether it ever arrived at the proper doorstep, we have no way of telling.
I believe that amounted to somewhere in the vicinity of about $10 million over 4 years.
Well, in the 1 year that we concentrated on, they did write approximately $5 million in receipts.
In that 1 year?
In the 1 year.
And we know the money left the country, but we don't know where it went.
No. And they had been in operation for approximately 3 or 4 years, so it's quite possible it would be $10 million.
And you can follow the problem of non-resident deductions right to the bank. An individual will come in, get a draft, saying he's going to send the money overseas to a relative. Then the very next day, we'll come back and cash the draft, but keep the receipt and file it as a deduction on income tax. Then take the problem a little further. A person claims to have a father, mother, sister, brother, or some relative in some foreign country that they're supporting, send the money, and then take a holiday and use that same money they sent to support that relative to pay for the trip.
Is there a law in the United States that gets rid of this problem of sending money to dependents?
Yes. As I understand it, the Americans do not allow a claim for relatives who do not reside in the United States.
Would it be a good thing here, do you think, if we had such a law and probably get rid of a lot of your problems?
Well, we think so. It would eliminate the necessity of having people sell receipts. And certainly, then if your relatives that you're claiming are in Canada, well, you can see them, we can see them, we can contact them, and you know that they're correct.
So at a time when everybody in the country is concerned about the economy, this is $100 million, perhaps $100 million plus, that could stay right in the country and you'd know where it is.
This is the other side of it. If $100 million leave the country, well, it's out of our economy.
Is there one particular group that is more responsible, one ethnic group, for doing this sort of thing?
No, no, we haven't found this. We found that it's applicable to various groups. And the only reservation I would say is in certain areas there would be a concentration of a certain ethnic group, and of course in that area this would be more prevalent for that group. Whereas you go to another area, it would be another ethnic group.
Virtually every person who walks the streets is capable of either supporting one or more non-resident dependents. Whether that dependent exists or not is impossible to determine. And if in excess of $100 million is to be accounted for each year in this country, income tax investigators say the hole must be plugged, the tax loophole eliminated.
Don't blame any special group. Although it's easier for some groups to be preyed upon by expats who say, come to me, pay me 5% of the face value, and you will not have to pay nearly so much income tax. It's quite obvious, and this story has broken in spades in Toronto, running around Vancouver now for months, if not years. There's only one thing that should be done. If you want to support your dependent relatives overseas, by all means support them. Send them as much money as you can afford. You should not, because of the huge loophole in the way the system works, you should not be allowed to deduct it from your income tax. The solution is as simple as that. Take out that Section 34 TLENR or whatever it is, T1ENR, and ban it altogether. And then nobody can fiddle the Canadian income tax in that aspect for upwards of $100 million this way, that way, or the next way. Next, we're going to go up on the hill. Well, not quite. We're going to have a little chat with Simon Fraser's former president, Pauline Jewett. Pauline Jewett has just confirmed to me that she's a professor on leave from Simon Fraser University. And actually, I planned this broadcast before the writ was issued. Which election are you in, quick?
I'm in the federal.
You're in the federal election. Who's your leader again? I forget. Which?
Oh, you didn't mention him earlier on this morning. It's Ed Broadbent. You
Broadbent.
Only mentioned the other two.
And the name of the provincial leader is Barrett, I think.
Yes, you mentioned that.
But the reason that you were on the program, to be on the program, was I canceled you out last week after I took a couple of what you probably thought were unkind slices at you last week, correct?
Yeah.
And why was I unkind? Merely to do two things. To say that you had no right, rather it was unwise of you to be on the picket line at SFU. And then I raised the question of your furnishings and how much you paid for them when you left the presidency in that beautiful home up there.
Yes.
Say your piece.
Say my piece. First of all, Jack, I have supported and do support, and I really want to be quite clear about that, the wage demands of the women's union. It's primarily women, as you know. It's 80% women, the union that is on strike at Simon Fraser. And I do support their wage demands. And if I just may take a moment.
Please do.
I'd like to clarify what they are asking, since the newspapers and radio seem to have got it wrong. It's a two-year contract.
Two-year contract.
Right, running from March 78 to March 80. In the first 8 months of the contract, there is no wage increase. It's zero, i.e. from March to November of 78, there's a zero increase. For the next 12 months, it's 6%. Mm-hmm. Now, both the union and the university have agreed on 6%, not 9, as has been said, for the next 12 months. For the last 4 months of the contract, that is from November of 79 to March of 80, it's an additional 3% that the union is asking. An additional 3%. Now, my own personal view is that this is a fair request, and I thought that you were making it sound as if it was, you know, an exorbitant request. And the reason I think it's fair is because most women in society, working women, are at the bottom level of the wage scale. Most of the unions where you have women in the majority of the union, like clerk typists and secretaries and library assistants and so on, are still at the bottom end. And one of the things I tried to do when I was president of Simon Fraser was to get more fully developed the concept of equal pay for work of equal value. And that's what I think we're struggling for.
It certainly is.
Good. And that's why I wanted to have people know that I openly support that concept, and I think so does the Canadian Human Rights Act, by the way.
But stop for a moment, please, Pauline Jewett. You were president of that university until December of last year.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you settle it before you left?
Well, there's not one person that settles it,
but you had the clout. There you were the president.
Well, I did my best to present my point of view as strongly as I could. I did it publicly as well, but primarily, of course, with the university's Board of Governors. And indeed, you see, when we settled our first contract with OUSI, 4 years ago almost, 3.5 years ago, we did, in fact, bring up the bottom two grades particularly. And it's quite true that the bottom two grades now, in a sense, lead the market. And that I considered to be one of the best things that was done. Now, other people simply don't share my view about this. Other people at the university didn't share my view about this. And they do not think that the women workers at Simon Fraser should be in the lead, so to
speak. Hear, hear.
And I think they should be.
But they're not all women workers.
80%.
We deal with them as persons, surely, nowadays.
Oh, well, I wish we could.
$930 to start, and a fairly simplified clerical job up at Simon Fraser for part-time shelving, if that's the for shelving or clerical work. Without even shorthand.
It's a clerk typist grade two that starts at $930 a month.
Hell of a good money.
You consider that good money?
Excellent conditions.
When you're considering also the responsibilities that are taken and the skills that are required, I don't consider it to be... You were talking as if it was really excessive. Now, when you compare that kind of job with other jobs in society, what do you want to take as an example? A trucker's assistant, perhaps? They do not get...
So I suppose I am...
As much as you were suggesting.
I suppose I am infected by the fact that we, the ordinary people who pay the bills, I've got the strong suspicion that we're being ripped off by all sections of academia.
Oh, well, I can't see that.
No, I know you can't see that, but from where we sit, it would seem to us that that's a position. And when they're offered...
6%.
And when they're offered arbitration with specifically comparable jobs... not just down the middle arbitration, the union won't take it. Why not?
Well, the market comparison analogy or strategy simply will destroy any hope of having equal pay for work of equal value at Simon Fraser.
Who am I to argue on that principle? I won't. The reason I took after you was because I thought, and I still think, the Fryer's action of slipping up there with his $20,000 check, urging them to block the roads, and then dashing off to his meeting.
Well, I don't...
was injudicious, to say the least.
I couldn't agree with you more.
And then you appeared on the same picket line.
I did not urge anyone to block any roads at all.
But you weren't on the picket line, you'll
tell me. No. Well, I went up in order to have a little bit of media so that I could get across my point of view on why I thought it was a justified strike.
But nobody can block public roads, especially for a university strike of all things.
Nor were they later. That's another thing, though. I agree... of course, entirely. And Dave Barrett said himself that this was a mistaken act.
Foolish. But on this program.
Yes, I was, as you know, wanting only to show this union, as I say, is 80% women who are the bottom paid people in our society. Women always suffer the first, that I did support the effort to try to get their wages raised. I'm not sure that 6%, you make it sound as if it was something enormous.
It is enormous compared to other people in certain categories. But let's not argue that. But it was the union, your friends in the union, who came in here and brought up the point at which I phoned you extraordinarily early one morning saying, 40,000 to the renovation
to
the house. And it was the union, I forget who told me about your purchase of the furniture, but of course, if I don't follow through on that and phone you about it and phone Swords about it, I'm guilty of protecting the establishment up there. So I had to phone you at 7 o'clock in the morning and say, how much did you pay for what furniture did you get out of the house? And who arranged the appraisal? Now, did that embarrass you?
No, not at all. I mean, it was agreed upon.
It's a perquisite of a university president to buy their old furniture.
I don't know. We had agreed that that this would be done at a fair appraised value.
Do you think it's right, though?
To make a purchase?
Because after all, the university had to put aside $13,000 for new furniture for the place.
Yeah, they would have probably done that. You see, what has not been understood about that is that the furniture for the house the part for the public rooms is furniture that can also be used in other parts of the university. There's two major public rooms in the house, which the university furnishes. And each president is allowed to choose the furniture required, and the university pays for it. The furniture that the president doesn't want is used elsewhere in the university, and I think that's what was not made clear.
I suppose not. You see, but the point I'm making again is the broad point. Here is a university, your old university, in which you're still a professor, in the middle of a strike over money. And suddenly, we, the people, find out they're putting a sauna bath in the basement of the president's house, 13,000 for new drapes, whatever, and you buy the furniture you want for the appraised value of $3,000, which is only part of the living room and dining room furniture. And we think, well, my God, they've got all that money to kick around in furniture and sauna baths. Why can't they pay the strikers the money they want? I know it's not an exact comparison. Yeah.
No, it isn't, because it comes out of capital funds.
The
new addition to the house, after all, a family is now living there.
Agreed. But
there are four people living in the house. I think they are justified in finishing. You know, the basement of that house has never been finished. Now, I didn't finish it while I was president.
Because you had no family then.
Because I didn't feel it was necessary. Mm-hmm. I thought the public rooms were sufficient, and I didn't feel it was necessary. I was a single person. And so I think it's really kind of inflating
agreed.
Pretty minor matter.
It was really a columnist's item, but in view of the fact that we have no columnists, people like myself must cover it for the record. But you get the point I'm making, that the strikers can say, $800,000 for a computerized, fertilized, water-sprinkling system on sports fields, and this and that for the president's house, and they can't pay us the money.
I'll tell you something that I really am quite concerned about, is that these expenditures, which are capital, whereas in the old days they used to come out of grants from the government, now they're coming out of borrowing.
Let's talk
and
about
that's something that concerns
Let's talk me. About your record and what you did or didn't do as president of Simon Fraser after this break. Pauline Jewett, professor on leave, former president Simon Fraser University. You know, I'm going to have to. You're running for the NDP.
Oh, great.
In New Westminster.
New Westminster-Coquitlam.
You have to let them say New Westminster.
They say it both ways in New Westminster.
Okay, New Westminster-Coquitlam. But in the meanwhile, so that I don't get all fouled up my equal time, give me a shot in Simon Fraser University, and that'll be political too. I've no doubt about it. But
no,
are you happy with what you achieved at Simon Fraser, or did you leave many things undone?
Well, I think everyone wants to have done more than they did, and I think the thing that makes me happiest is that the three or four, about four main things I wanted to do were all started, and some really so well along that I think I can take some pride in them. Jack, you remember we talked when you were doing radio almost the first day that I moved to British Columbia and came to Simon Fraser, and one of the things I said then that I was really anxious to do and to encourage was looking at the Canadian market when we needed new faculty. There was a tendency still, because Simon Fraser had to bring in so many permanent faculty from the States, there was a tendency then to continue to look to the States for new faculty.
And bribe them with tenure too.
Well, not usually you have to earn tenure. There's no question about that.
All right. What was the percentage of non-Canadian faculty when you went there?
About half.
50%.
And
what was it when you left?
It would be about, it must be getting close to 70%.
Oh, UBC at 75%, according to Kenny.
Yes. The important thing is, I'm not sure that it is. The important thing is, though, that every year we increasingly search the Canadian market for new faculty. Now, some disciplines you couldn't find the person.
Yeah.
But I considered that to be one of the major things, that we just turned our eyes to Canada a little bit more. We still, of course, have visiting faculty from all over the world, as we should, but we turned our eyes to Canada. And a second thing that came along after that was to try to encourage more women faculty. And I remember one of the administrators was heard to say, well, thank goodness I'm a Canadian, now if I can only get a sex change.
he'd be home free for his tenure. But didn't you have a huge battle with CAUT? Was that finally
was another,
resolved? The Canadian Association of
and that
University
was another,
Teachers
another thing
who
that
blacklisted the university.
Yes, and that took about 2 years. And finally, the CAUT did remove the censure and boycott when they saw that we were making every effort to resolve the issue. Now that was, I was working on that for about 2 years.
That was your trickiest battle.
That was a toughie. Mm-hmm.
That was a real toughie.
Well, I think both of those battles were tough.
But in your times at Simon Fraser, after Strand, there was Strand who went through all the RCMP caper and the, when they sat in somewhere or other. Then along you came and the faculty were still fairly nice, the students were still fairly noisy. And now if you go up to Simon Fraser, through the picket lines, you will find a very square, fat cat, smug student body which wants nothing but peace and quiet and security. What caused the change?
Well, there's been a change. Student generations last about 4 or 5 years, don't they? Not the 20 years that most generations do. And the whole lifestyle of students has changed. And of course, the fact that it's so hard to get jobs has made students far more serious and conscientious about their work than they were in the late 60s when the job market was still pretty good. And I think it's a change in lifestyle. It's a concern about getting jobs. Another thing that we did while I was president was encourage people to come back to the university after they've been in the home or in the workforce for a number of years. And when I arrived at Simon Fraser, I think about 5% of the students were older students. 95% were in the traditional age group.
Right.
Last year, about 40% were older students. And those people who have been in the home or in the workforce and then come to university to study, it seems to me, are motivated differently.
They're the best students, I would suggest.
They're very good students, and they're motivated perhaps a little differently from the ones in the traditional age group.
Convince me, though, that in these times of restraint, which everyone advocates, no matter who they are, we're all advocating restraint of some kind, that we can afford to take mature students back, or anybody who wants to go to university can go to university. Again, here I go to my Machiavellian conspiracy. I know that the enrollment is slackening. Is there a drive by faculties to get anybody at all into universities to keep up the budgets? I know that's an evil question.
Actually,
you know
that
what
hasn't happened in British Columbia.
Has not happened.
No. There's some talk that it's happened in Ontario.
Yeah.
There's been some lowering of entrance standards. There has been no lowering of entrance standards. Indeed, they've been slightly raised in British Columbia. So one can't say that there's that kind of
You don't feel it's a feather-bedding educational establishment?
Actually, you know, what we need so much nowadays is to have more people getting more and better and stronger intellectual skills than they've had. Because, you know, Canada is always getting itself in the position where it suddenly says, oh dear, we've got too many educated people, and then it turns off the tap. 10 years later, they're having to import their skills because they haven't kept the tap on enough. And we do that time and time again, and I'm just hoping we won't do it this time.
Can't stay away from politics. I just can't.
Okay.
You're an ex-lib. How well did you know Pierre Trudeau?
As well, probably, as anybody that wasn't a very close friend. By that, I mean that he never encouraged really close friendships. He's always been a person that went on his own.
How do you explain his incredible public declamations these days, like, get off your bleep?
I guess he's just getting old.
Was he always arrogant?
No, I don't think. Had that arrogant streak, but I don't ever recall him making such criticism of lazy farmers and accusing people of being unemployed as if that was their wish to be unemployed. I mean, most people I meet that are unemployed want jobs. He makes it sound as if they're all wanting to be unemployed. Mm. He didn't. I don't recall him being like that before. I think it's he's getting snarky, and it's a quality that obviously his own advisors would rather wish he would
drop.
Yeah.
Funny, isn't it? Why are you a socialist? What kind of socialist are you?
Oh, I
are
am.
You?
I am.
Are you what Bennett says?
Bennett.
What did you make of that? Did you happen to see my little interview with
Yeah, and you
Der
gave
Prim?
Him. Yes, he did use the word National Socialist 3 times, and you gave him every opportunity to say it had been a slip. And he didn't take those opportunities. So I can only think it was deliberate, and he wanted to confuse the public mind.
Don't you think there's a possibility?
And I think that's
he didn't know.
Despicable. Oh, of course he knew. Everyone knows the Nazis. Everyone knows. Even the young man that phoned you that morning was only 20, I think, and said he knew what the reference was to. But he couldn't believe it was deliberate.
All right, who are you facing in Coquitlam, New Westminster-Coquitlam? Who are your opponents?
There's a liberal and there's a conservative and I think a communist.
Remember the names?
Yes, the liberal is Les Garrison.
Oh, yes. Well, he had Pierre out helping him. I don't need to feel too badly about that. In fact, the Premier said, if you don't want me back again, vote against Garrison, right? Who's the... He's a liberal.
Yeah. And the conservative is Marg Gregory. And she
Marg,
ran...
Have you met Marg yet?
Oh, yes. And she ran last time.
Isn't that hanging Marg? Isn't that hanging Marg, Linda? Yeah, she's the capital punishment lady.
Yeah.
She's the one that got the 800,000 signatures for John, what's his name, on radio. Reynolds. Let's not be chintzy about it.
That's nice of you, Jack.
Hey, thank you for coming in this morning,
thank
Pauline
you for
Jewett.
Having me.
No, I have no final nasty questions. Thank you, Pauline Jewett. Next, the man in the Borsalino. Borsalina. The man in the Borsalino. What's the program you're doing today?
It's a sports thing with lots of politics thrown. Got to do it properly.
When you put the skimmer on, now give it a little bit of rakish tilt. You look like somebody drunk on New Year's Eve. It's a little bit small for the.
What size is this hat?
That's 7 1/8, and you're about 7 and you're about 8. You're about a size 8. One of the bigger heads.
I have the same size head as Churchill.
Well, too big.
7 3/4.
That hat don't fit you. It needs a stretch.
Ladies and gentlemen.
It fits me though.
Ladies and gentlemen, put it on.
Of course. I mean, as a certain when you got a skin infield where like I have, you
That's
always put
camera.
The hat on.
That's your camera.
Ah. Camera 2, it says. Look right into camera 2, the guy says. Pointing to camera 2.
This is Richard Beddoes. Tricky Dicky Beddoes.
Stop that. You used to be my city editor.
Oh,
a million years ago.
Don't let's tell these.
A million years ago.
As a matter of fact,
when you were making $45 a week.
I'll tell you what
happened. I'm lucky to get it.
I'll tell you what happened. I'll tell you how Beddoes came to be a magnificent Ontario-type columnist, national columnist that he now is. I was assistant city editor of the Vancouver Sun. Earl Smith was the city editor.
And not a very good one.
I'm not about to cut the throat of old friends of mine.
Since when?
And Smith said to me, there's a Fink coming in from, we're going to try out as a reporter. His name is Richard Beddoes. So Beddoes comes to me and I said, what kind of reporter are you? He says, oh, I've been around, you know. He was wearing a velvet collar and a bowler hat, which looked most unusual in the Vancouver Sun of the late 40s, early 50s. I said, go out and cover this fire. He went out and he covered the fire. They came back to me and I said, Beddoes, you will never, ever be a reporter. Go work in the sports department. I fired him from the city side. He got a job in the sports side, and like the rest of those people in sports who can neither read nor write, nor swing their hands in unison with their legs, he became a great success. And I wish to congratulate you on your rise to the top. Now spell the word fictitious.
It was wrong here.
F-I-C-T-I-O-2-U,
whatever it is. You had it right when you orally said it.
That's right.
It was wrong here.
And I corrected it
on here.
I mean,
you run this program, you run it. I mean, you run it like you used to run a city room.
Do you know
everybody, how can a guy be a floor director having you as sort of the maitre d' of the place?
Already two people have been fired for wrongly spelling fictitious.
Have they been fired?
No,
I'll bet they've been fired. Bet they haven't been fired.
Spell coercion.
Coercion. C-O-E-E-R-C-I-O-N. Try me again. You know, I mean, Tim.
Neophyte.
Neophyte, N-E-O-P-H-Y-T-E.
Succinct.
Succinct, S-U-C-C-I-N-C-T. What is this? I mean, you should have asked the president of the university.
You must have gone back to school after you left the Vancouver Sun City site.
Listen, what a terrible kind of city room you ran. It was always loud, Webster here, and you were raising hell with a lot of people. You made Simaholt, distinguished parliamentarian from what, Kingsway, Burnaby? She bawled more often because Webster raised his voice. You were always doing that.
Simmer was very good at getting stories. She only had one major trouble.
Couldn't write them.
She couldn't type them, far less write them.
Well, yes. What she did, as they say, all of her stuff looked like typing instead of writing. But she was a pretty good reporter.
Excellent reporter.
Excellent reporter. Especially on guys who are going to hang.
First-class reporter, yeah.
Yeah.
Great and going to hangings.
Especially. Covered more hangings than any broad in the history of Canadian journalism. Lovely lady.
Great.
Is she going to get reelected, Holt?
I've been reading your column in the Globe and Mail as a matter of compulsion in the last few weeks.
You don't have to, Jack. I mean, it's not, you know. It's
I like to know something about the people I'm about to interview and their current status in life. I listen to you from time to time on As It Happens, and I want you to expose that show from coast to coast.
That's how can you expose it? You have Barbara Fram on every time she's here, or Fram, as you call her. She's always, I mean, you're a big buddy of Barbara Fram's, the host of that program.
But I'd like you to make it perfectly clear that that is not a live program, that it's taped.
Indeed, it's not a live program.
And edited.
Not edited too much, but edited somewhat. And you'd edit it, too, if you ran it. It's the most successful public affairs program in the history of the corporation.
You know why I'm attacking it?
Because you never take on the listen, you never kick the old apple lady. I understand that. You always hit the guy with the top hat. Sure, that's why you're taking
I'm
it
jealous,
on.
I'm jealous, that's why.
She does a great job on it, and it's right.
She
it's taped.
Does.
Some listen, I'm host that program occasionally. It's not all
taped.
You have
to pay for that.
Not enough.
Not enough.
If 250 a pop, and that's not enough.
Not enough.
It's not really enough.
Welfare rates for a man of your distinction.
I get other jobs, though. I don't need that.
How many jobs do you have?
Five.
Are you allowed to moonlight on the Globe and Mail?
Indeed. And the guy that's here now going to...
It's going to stop it here.
If they ever publish again. I mean, Dick Clark Davies been here, what, since November? Has put one issue out under his name.
None.
He didn't get out. He told me one.
No, he's not telling you the truth. He did not get one paper out.
Listen, when I worked at the Vancouver Sun, there was always a ban on moonlighting. Erwin Schweinhardt, who was then the sports editor, I was Jack, I led the league in suspensions at the Vancouver Sun because Swangard didn't let me making 25 lousy bucks on CKNW. You might scoop yourself.
You'll do anything for a dollar.
Exactly. It was awful. Bill Hughes, just been fired.
The last time I almost brought four lawsuits.
Well, all that happened to Hughes, I'm told by Herb Capozzi, is that he got caught between Emily and Frank Griffiths. One of the great squeeze plays of all
stop
time.
Stop it. And I'll have to hit the kill button. Will you behave yourself?
Well, why would I behave myself? Anyway, listen.
How many? Name your other four jobs. As it happens.
I do as it happens.
As it happens.
As it happens. I sometimes show up at the Globe and Mail, a toad and snail, whatever you call it, mop and pail.
Mop and pail.
I do television every night for CHCH TV
in
Hamilton.
What kind of television do you do?
This kind of television. This is the best kind of television.
You had a riot of success.
Why not?
Loud-mouthed phony like me.
Exactly. You can sit down and open your mouth and when the red light goes on and
CHCH,
not need a script.
That's three jobs. What's your fourth one?
Well, I do a lot of little extra writing jobs, Jack.
Oh, Flackery.
Yes. Not Flackery.
For Ballard.
No.
You write Ballard's lines.
No, I don't. He's wonderful. You can't write Ballard's lines. They're all obscene. And at 9 o'clock, what are we here, 10 o'clock in the morning, you couldn't get on your program. We had him on at night. Hell opens at 10:30 in Toronto. You could put Ballard on then. Trudeau would be great after 10:30 in Toronto when hell opens. Listen, he didn't say anything very bad Saturday, Trudeau.
Get off your beep.
Get off your ass is what he said. And since what's so wrong about that is I can't believe that you would be offended, a dockside Scot, when you were a city editor. Those words were tame a quarter of a century ago.
Look, my language off the air is what you'd say, extremely colorful, but I think you must maintain certain standards. What that phrase showed was the incredible arrogance of Pierre Elliott Trudeau.
Listen,
a man, as I said this morning, has never dirtied a fingernail in his life.
And you're right. He was born to the purple. His old man had made multi-million selling gas stations during the Depression in this country. You're right. He was born to the purple. But unlike
we don't want the language and television
what's new about
descend
him?
Descend to your normal conversation.
My normal conversation is very clean. I don't think there's anything wrong with ASSS. What I'm offended by is people like Trudeau perhaps being profane in the sense of the Lord and all the rest of
insulting
that.
Insulting a working guy with that
kind of
language.
Oh, come on, he's always done that.
It's not nice.
Listen, when there were some striking bus drivers in Montreal at, what, eight
Mange
years ago?
De la merde.
Merde is what he worded. Everybody knows that that's the that's feces in
that's
French.
That's right, good.
So the truth is
but you
that
see,
Pauline Jewett is wrong when she tells...
You wouldn't use that other one in television, and I wouldn't let you use it. I'd
kill no, I wouldn't use it.
No,
I
you wouldn't.
I wouldn't use it in print where it shows up occasionally.
No, that's right.
No, of course not.
Hold your breath.
Listen, he doesn't...
Take a break. Take a break. Cut him off. Take a break.
Program. We ain't going to do it.
Next time I'm in Toronto, we got to do that. We got to
okay.
See it.
All right, we'll go over. We'll do it. Yeah.
Mr. Beddoes is a columnist for the Toronto Globe and Mail. He's a man of great distinction and distinguishment. Spends most of his time in the paper, attacking the Arab community, the Jewish community, protecting the homosexual community, attacking the police.
I beg your pardon.
I've been reading a column for
you. I do not. You haven't been reading it properly. I do not attack like Doug Collins, who I think... I'm not Collins. He's a guy that would attack those minorities. I don't attack them at all. I'm in support of them. I'm against policemen in Toronto.
In principle.
Indeed, who give minorities a tough time, including homosexuals. And there's a big homosexual community.
You should tell that story. You should tell that story quite seriously about the... What was the name of that paper?
Which paper?
Paper that won the action, that was acquitted.
Oh, News and Views.
No, Politic, the Body Politic.
Oh, the Body Politic, yeah, which is the...
This was a paper, ladies and gentlemen, which was charged under the obscenity laws or some kind of laws for advocating a form of pedophilia. And much to everyone's surprise, the judge or the jury or both acquitted the newspaper.
The judge.
The judge acquitted the newspaper, causing great consternation, I suppose, in the realms of the establishment in Toronto.
Ooh, precisely.
Where did you stand on the Body Politic issue?
I was on their side. I mean, listen, it's a kind of liberalism, and not a phony liberalism, to be, they were charged with distributing scurrilous material through the mails.
Right. And it was pretty bleeding scurrilous.
Oh, come on. What it was boys loving men loving boys, that sort of, and it's pedophilia.
That's
goes
right.
on all
pedophilia.
The time. Pedophilia. Goes on all the time, much more in the heterosexual community than in the homosexual community, by far.
But then your attack turned on a Toronto police newspaper of some kind.
Called News and Views, which then called the homosexuals, queers, fags.
And gave them a really rough and obnoxious time.
No, obnoxious time. And what? Listen, they're entitled.
You are a member of a minority yourself now.
Wasps, like you.
A pinko in a wasp suit.
I'm not a pinko at all. How could I come? I make too much money to be a pinko. Maybe Jewett is a pinko, but I'm not.
You're not a pinko.
No, I'm like you. I make too much money to be a pinko.
When you ran for alderman in Etobicoke.
Yes.
You did you?
Yes, and made it.
What was
first
your platform?
Pop,
what was your platform?
Throw the bastards out.
That was it. That
yes,
was your
I had a big sign,
line.
Yeah. A big sign on
now
my lawn.
The use of that word in that context is perfectly
it's
proper.
Politicians, of course.
Yes. I would have said, throw the rascals out.
No. I brought them my lawn, had a big sign exactly.
Were you defeated at the next election?
I didn't stand for the next election.
You only did one shot and
one
ran
shot,
away.
Batting 1,000. You can't be any better than that.
Did you win at all?
Well, yeah, won. Of course I won.
Why didn't you run for mayor of Toronto?
I can't afford to be mayor of Toronto. The mayor of Toronto only makes $45,000 lousy dollars a year, and that is not enough money for people who want to live like you and I do.
Don't bring me into your
on,
upper
Webster.
Class, affluent society.
Oh, that is this. Who needs the heat? When you work for the Globe and Mail, you're the opposition anyway. Who needs the...
Hey, just a minute, though. Yeah, I want to get into the local politics.
Oh, Clark Davey.
Clark Davey. You see, Clark Davey has made it perfectly clear that moonlighting with competing media for the boys in the sun is out.
Well,
he didn't
act like that at the Globe and Mail.
He let you moonlight at the Globe and Mail.
Not in competing publications in print. I couldn't work for Maclean's magazine because they want the same advertising.
Well, that
as
means Fotheringham is finished in Maclean's then.
It may well be. May well be. It could be.
Either that or he's finished at the Sun.
Depends what kind of a contract Alan has. I don't know if Clark can take care of that. But he never, ever stopped us from on this medium. I was always on it. And radio always.
For a very good reason. You promote your column in the newspaper by making these public appearances.
And Jack, that applied to the Vancouver Sun 25 years ago, but you couldn't sell it to people. Hal Strait thought it was fine, mm-hmm. but guys like Swangard and those lesser hirelings try to clip guy's wings.
You are insulting the man we admire and to whom we're about to build a $163 million multiplex with the help of the federal and provincial government.
You're going to build it in the worst place if you're going to build it at the sea at the
P&E. What do you know about it? When were you last in this town?
I'm here every year to see a lady. I'm here all regularly.
Well, where would you build a multiplex,
downtown,
you smart aleck know-it-all?
You know it should be downtown.
Where downtown?
I don't know where downtown, but that's where it should be. Like Maple Leaf Gardens belongs, as it does, in the heart.
Speaking of Maple Leaf Gardens,
yes.
I went to a hockey game at Maple Leaf Gardens.
Recently?
Yes, and I phoned up somebody and got, I had to buy a ticket. I think it was $14.
No.
$12.
$12.50.
I could not fit into the seat.
No, they've narrowed the seats.
They are so narrow.
Yes, they've narrowed the seats so that they can get more in. Of course, that's, it used to be, when I went to Toronto 14 years ago, 13,000. Now it's like 17,000, so they've narrowed the seats.
Did Ballard get steak served when he was in jail for his tax fraud?
No, that's not
true. Are you a PR for Ballard?
No, I'm not.
Well, why don't you tell me the truth about that?
Harold Ballard, listen, he went with us to Russia in 72 for the first
time. Who is us?
The hockey people that went to the
Eagleson's
hockey series.
Eagleson's boys.
One of Eagleson's troop. They beat the Russians.
Uh-huh.
Henderson scores a winning goal with 24 seconds.
Remember it well.
Ballard went with that trip. He shouldn't have got out of the country. He's going to go to jail, but they somehow got some reprieve for him, and he got out. And he said, I got to get out to go to Russia to sort of get equipped to handle the food that I'm going to get the Kingston can. Ballard did, the story was.
How much fraud?
$340,000.
Income tax.
I don't know. That's the same amount of money, I think.
It was tax evasion.
Right, tax evasion. But he reached into the shareholders' a coffee jar and took out $340,000. He paid it all back.
Wait, a guy here who did $3
million. Oh, Ballard's a piker. He did one whole year
in the bucket.
At a place called Mill Haven. He was there for 12 months. So they got a rink there. And he ran the rink in the wintertime. And in the summertime, and naturally the ice melted, became a pond. And so Ballard then took care of the ducks and geese on that pond in the summer months. So he says to me, we got to do a book on me. And I said, yeah, we already got a title. Birdman of Mill Haven.
He didn't do the book.
Not yet. We're going to do it.
You're going to do it?
Oh, he's wonderful. Never ran from it. His partner.
So you're going to finish up as a flack for Ballard?
No, not a flack, but he's wonderful. He comes, listen, if you had him here, he'd break every television tube in the Lower Mainland to be his language, but he'd be wonderful. He's real. His partner in crime was the late Stafford Smythe, who killed himself, and rather than go to jail, he drank himself to death.
Allegorically killed himself.
Allegorically speaking, yes, yes.
You know what allegorical means?
Don't
try and explain it. We're both lost. We can use it.
It's a figure of speech.
Hold your breath. This particular figure of speech will be quiet for the next 2 minutes only. Richard C. Beddoes is in town for a... It's not Richard.
You're talking about Richard C. Malone.
I'm not talking about Richard C. Malone.
I am not.
I'm talking about Dick Beddoes. Yeah, that's enough of that.
It's not Richard H. Not Richard C.
What Richard is it? Richard H.
Yeah, it's how old
are you now?
Jack, you never tell. You're up.
I'll be 61 if you want to send me a present on Sunday.
61?
On Sunday. Don't look a day more than 50.
No, you don't. You don't. You still holler and shout like you did 25 years ago.
When 30 we were all years ago.
No,
dreadful,
but,
isn't it?
Yeah, listen.
Do you think I'm sane?
No, you're never, but you weren't sane when you were a city editor or assistant city editor. That's 55 a week.
Do you think I should get treatment?
Yeah, you should. What became of all those guys? Mac Reynolds was, you had Paul St. Pierre was your top guy, and Reynolds was your top feature.
Paul was our hero. He went out on rescue missions.
Bill Fletcher was the best hack we had.
He's gone.
Too bad.
Yeah.
He's an outstanding
nice
hack. And you had a guy called Bill, the other guy, went to...
Rose.
Him
Shot.
Too. Yeah, them too. But there was somebody else. You had four top guys. You had Fletcher, you had Reynolds, and you had St. Pierre, and one other, Bill Ryan. Those were your four top guys.
Bill's in PR. And there was Webster, of course.
But you were the city editor. Then you had underneath them some pretty good
Ron
guys.
Ron Haggart, Jack Wasserman.
Outstanding people.
Ray Timpson.
Good people.
Ron Gadsby.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what Ron Gadsby, how good Ron, he's a nice, interesting guy. But those...
Enough of that.
Alec Young.
That's what I was going to ask you. Why are you in town, Mr. Beddoes? Just a minute, please. Inquiring.
I was dragooned. Oh, you're like the inquiring reporter. Yes. I was dragooned by Herb Capozzi to come out here. I'm a Canada's substitute. They obviously couldn't get somebody else who knows Stu Keat better than I do. I never worked for Stu Keat. I'm here to, I guess, talk about Stu Keat tonight. He's the former publisher of the Vancouver Sun.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me make the announcement so you get it clearly, lucidly, and succinctly. Tonight in the Hotel Vancouver, there is a dinner put on by the Canadian Diabetic Association. Tickets, $200 a pop. $175 of which is tax deductible because it goes to the Canadian Diabetic Association. And because they couldn't get a named speaker, they left it far too late and Capozzi fouled up the organization. The same Capozzi has come up with an excellent substitute which is better than any named speaker. There's going to be a roast of our estimable friend, J. Stuart Keat, retired the publisher of the Vancouver Sun. And the roasters include Beddoes, Webster, Senator Lawson,
Denny Boyd.
Jock McKinnon from the golf club. Good old Jock.
I thought he was
Might
dead.
Show us his war wounds. Bruce who? Bruce Lowther from Victoria. Who else? Need a couple more stars.
Who's Bruce Lowther?
He's a reporter from Victoria. He's all right. He's no Beddoes, mind you. He's pretty good, though. Listen. I mean, you're outstandingly rude to people when you're doing a roast.
Well, why not? Is there some reason for... It's roast. That's the name of the game. If it's toast, then you... The guy's not dead yet. Keat, right?
No. He's only 65.
Right. I mean, should still be working, maybe.
Good for 20 years.
Listen, the kind of work he did, he could be good for at least 100. He didn't work
if
hard.
If you wish to take it at $200 a pop, phone the office of Herb Capozzi. And what's the number? First time he's been off camera in his life. I just refuse to put him on because he's such a publicity glutton. 688? 2024. You can hear the Italian accent in the background. 688-2024. And he will deliver by cab anywhere in the Lower Mainland region tickets at $200 a pop. Rafi, is that her name? R-A? F-F-E-Y. Rafi is taking orders now. How many of you sold? 300. They've room for another 40. Another $8,000.
Can you believe that they'll draw any people with the... I think the Oscars are on tonight. That's what we're going up against.
Don't mention what's up against
it. Why not? I mean, what is it? Does it matter? He's already sold out.
Would you rather listen to Webster or watch the Oscars?
With Carson on, I wouldn't mind watching the Oscars. And it's 11 o'clock. He might be a little bit dirty in some of the things he's got to say.
Fred, we got a sign?
Have we got to leave?
No. The Vancouver Canucks with a total of 63 points is in the playoffs.
What a ripoff. I mean, the Canucks. They're the kind of franchise in hockey that Capozzi used to have with the BC Lions. Lousy, essentially. Mm-hmm. But the Lions finally won a Grey Cup. This club will not win the Stanley Cup till the year 3001.
What are we going now? 9 years? 10 years?
9 years. You're in your ninth. You're finishing your ninth season. Going to Philadelphia to play against the Flyers and should bomb out. It should be over in one game. You know, you may, if you're Philadelphia against Vancouver, you mail in the points. You don't worry about playing them. It's just stupid that a club with, there were so many other teams that don't make it. You know, this club doesn't deserve to be anywhere in the playoffs. To be second.
Why did they set up the league in that way with the what Little Davidson calls the sweat hog division? Where the Chicago and us,
nicely said,
Chicago
Jack.
and we get into it.
I don't know. They just shouldn't be in at all. Everybody has to get in.
Well, what about this expansion? Do I want to go and see Edmonton, Winnipeg, and the Quebec, whatever
Listen,
it is?
Listen, Edmonton and Quebec this year would be far, far better than Chicago and Vancouver. Listen, Edmonton and Winnipeg go into that sweat hog division. Right away, they're contenders. They can be 1-2 next year with Vancouver fourth. I mean, Bill Hughes had difficulty at CKNW, I think.
Now he's trying to run a hockey team.
Why should he have been president of a hockey club? Yeah, he know about hockey?
Look, why didn't we get a decent coach and general manager right from the what go? Why couldn't we have bought somebody like Scotty Bowman?
We could have had Punch Imlach. There's enough money out here. Punch Imlach would
have
What
about Joe Crozier?
Oh, come on. He's a puffed up.
Is he?
Joe Crozier, of course.
I thought he was good, Joe.
No, Crozier. He's one of those guys who's very full of himself.
Oh, I've forgotten. There are people out there. Vast numbers in the wasteland of television who want to speak to Beddoes on whatever. I will not open my mouth. If you promise to not use Prime Minister Trudeau's language, I will not open my mouth. He promises.
I wish he'd use some language with vigor. That's what I'm talking about. He didn't use any language at all.
Okay. Beddoes, to you, now. Pleasure, Mr. Beddoes, that I further expand your notoriety.
Wonderful.
Go ahead to Tricky Dicky.
Good morning, sir. Thank you very much for the insight into Webster's top hat syndrome. He's
top hat syndrome.
He's obviously having a go at Trudeau. during this election campaign. One thing, he let Pauline Jewett disseminate some misinformation.
Forget Pauline Jewett. Go at Beddoes.
Well,
or go away.
What was the misinformation?
Never mind the misinformation. Well, he's on about that.
The misinformation was in respect to the lazy farmers.
Complaining farmers. You want me to change every word?
Said lazy farmers.
Do I sit here all the time and vet everything that every politician says? Complaining farmers. Now get it, Beddoes, or go away.
Very good to see you, sir. And it's good to see that you can stand up to his sort of type of pressure.
Thank you, sir.
Come on, it's bombast. Hello.
Go ahead, please.
I would...
Go ahead.
Dick, I'd like to know why this province can't build a hockey team like they do, like they have in Toronto and Montreal.
There's Toronto.
There's a Vancouver syndrome. I mean, it's a loser land, right? This is what Vancouver's like. It's got a Narcissus complex. You look in the mirror every day and look at Stanley Park and the water and the mountains, and I got it so good. Why should I try very hard? When I worked for Webster at the Vancouver Sun, we stopped printing news once it got beyond the lower mainland. That's typical of Vancouver. We didn't know where Chilliwack was, for God's sake, 25 years ago.
Yeah, but the city, the province itself has such a great hockey team.
I mean, it's giving you the
answer. A great hockey team? You've got to be joking, the hockey team.
Well, the Leafs have got such a great team, such as...
They don't have a great team.
Canadians and all the money in Canada.
No,
why can't Canada have another good representation?
It's just relative. The Maple Leafs are not a good hockey club and should be knocked out by Atlanta Flames in two games if the Flames are trying in this upcoming playoff.
Montreal Canadiens, all the teams, the players they have in their franchise. Look at the players.
Look at what players? I've been looking at them all year. They don't have a great club in Toronto at all.
Well, why not? Why do we have such a garbage team here in Vancouver?
Well, one of the reasons is that Vancouver should not be in, or a lot of clubs should be out. They're going to expand to 21 next year, as Webster said.
No, like Webster said this morning, why didn't they go out at one time and try and get Scotty Bowman to coach?
Well, I'm not sure that makes any difference, but Punch Imlach was available, went to Buffalo, and made Buffalo a Stanley Cup contender in four seasons.
What you're saying is, as has been said many a time, and applied to Capozzi's Lions.
When they get
out here, that's the land of the Lord.
That's true. There's
Jack,
something like that.
You got to go and get the best managers and best coaches, and we try to do that in soccer, and it pays off.
In soccer now, you're going to sell the franchise for $3.5 million.
No, you're not. You were there, you dummy. You know what happened on that line. We're not selling them for anything. They're staying here.
Well, you would
build
if
us
you could.
A stadium. They're here forever.
How much will you take for your soccer franchise?
Nothing.
$5 million.
Won't sell it.
Won't sell it.
Not for sale.
What soccer? Does it have a chance?
Yes, it has now. Funnily enough, it has a chance to go.
Well,
this is good.
In Toronto, they'll draw 18,000 tops and down from there. Hello.
Let's try somebody else. I want somebody to nail you.
Go ahead. Hello.
Hello, Beddoes.
Sir.
Yeah, it's great to have a breath of fresh air.
Thank you.
I don't agree with your politics.
You don't know what my politics are.
You called yourself a liberal wasp. That's what you called yourself.
Is that so bad to be a liberal wasp?
Not pinko, but a liberal wasp.
Go ahead, sir.
You're doing a good job on him, Jack. One quick question. Are the Argos going to fold next year and give us all another breath of fresh air?
The Argos, the league, that's such a bad league. They got a chance to win the Grey Cup. Be the first time since 52 should they accomplish it. If they make the playoffs, it'll be the first time in many, in a decade.
Okay, last...
They got a chance. Yeah, they got a chance.
Do I get the distinct feeling you finally have a word positive about Vancouver sporting scene saying that we might possibly be in the Grey Cup?
Might we be in the Grey Cup?
No, as long as Edmonton's the power in football. The Grey Cup. They won one Grey Cup in this town. Capozzi in 64 got lucky.
That's right.
Got lucky.
No, we got unlucky in 63.
He broke somebody's
lucky
leg.
In 64.
Oh, 63, listen.
Herb, I want to ask you a personal question.
Oh, dear.
Go right ahead.
Is that your own hair?
I would hope so.
How old are you now, Herb?
54 on April the 24th. How do you like that, Jack?
Just incredible, isn't it?
Yeah.
Muscles ripple on his tum-tum. He lifts weights every day.
But he sat a lot on the bench with the Alouettes when he played.
I never had to use much exercise, Jack. That's what does it.
He was a cheerleader. Hello.
Yes.
He is not a cheerleader. There's nothing odd about Herb.
One of your listeners is here. Hello. One of your viewers.
I'm running the program.
Okay.
Go ahead to Mr. Beddoes.
Dick. How about some one-liners about your peers in Toronto that many of us Westerners miss so much? We have to put up with Webster, but there's men like Jim Vipon, Jim Hunt, Gordy Sinclair, Pierre Burton, and so on. How about a few one-liners?
Okay, I've got
all second rate.
One-liners.
Well,
Vipon.
Vipon has just been retired as sports editor of the Globe and Mail. A very nice guy.
That's a kiss. That's a
nice man.
Kiss of death.
Nice man.
Hunt. Who is Hunt?
Jim Hunt is a very loud, obnoxious radio guy who'd be great in this. He's a tall Al Davidson. That's what he is. And we had Ballard, we had Howard Ballard on a television program I'm involved in called Overtime After the Hockey Games in midweek in Toronto. And he dislikes Hunt's comments so much, he said, that guy's name is not Hunt. I'll give you, this is what it is. You've got a chance, give me the first three letters of the alphabet is what Hunt's name really is. And so I said, oh, you mean Jim Bunt. I mean, Jack, I mean, it's a clean story. Go ahead. You're going about
Take a break.
One stadium, him and Whitehead built the other stadium.
Swungard Stadium.
You remember when do you remember when Whitehead quit to go into the electrical business?
He ever managed to survive 90 years at the province.
Gordon Sinclair, one-liner.
Gordon Sinclair. Does he make as much money as you do?
About
six. He's Gordon Sinclair, it's over for Sink now, he ought to quit, but he's wonderful.
Burton.
Mr. Canada, is that what they call him, Burton?
You like him.
He's exposed so much he ought to be arrested, Burton.
That's a good lie.
I like that.
I like the way with that one.
Recycled.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, it's good to see someone else than a politician, Webster. This guy's really, he's okay. He's got guts.
Have you ever seen him before?
Yeah, I'm from Toronto.
You sound like you're from Toronto, too.
Read the man just for his, attack on how silly it all is at times.
Wonderful. It is, the sports world. The jocks, forget them, they're for laughs.
Why don't they get six teams again? I really liked it. I could follow hockey.
Exactly. You can't identify now with 21 teams. I'm for him.
From Victoria.
Yes, hi.
Hi. Speak right up.
Getting back to the realignment, Dick Beddoes.
Yep.
You know, Trotsky truly deserves the scoring leadership. They're playing teams like Philadelphia, Atlanta, New York Rangers in their own division.
You're talking about Brian Trotsky, the Islanders. In six-team hockey, he'd be the third right winger for somebody and get maybe 15 goals.
You think so?
Yeah, of course.
You're funny.
Listen, we're talking about a guy, Trotsky's a center iceman, but in the days of Béliveau when he was right and Henry Richard when he was right and Keon and those people, this guy would have trouble making NHL. He might be in Rochester in the AHL.
I don't believe so.
Okay, you're entitled to the view. It's your call.
Right.
Okay. Vernon, B.C. to Richard Beddoes.
Vernon, B.C.
May I speak to Dick Beddoes?
That's why he's here.
Go ahead, man.
I'm from Vancouver. I'm from Hamilton, Ontario.
Oh, listen, I do some work in Hamilton, Ontario, yes.
Oh, you work with Charrington, eh? How is he?
He's wonderful. Webster calls Tom Charrington a pompous phony. That's not true. He happens to be the best news voice at 11 o'clock in the whole Toronto market, including Buffalo.
You mean his voice?
Yeah, you know what I'm with?
I must get a voice.
He's a fine reader.
Well, that's Bill Stevenson.
Is that Bill Stevenson?
Reads a great bread ad, Stevenson. Go ahead, man.
You know who I'm wishing? I'd like to see Charrington come out here and be on with Jack Webster. It would be a good show.
Would that so? Well, we'll have him out here on with me.
I'm a Scotchman, too.
Big
I'm right
fellow,
from Hamilton.
Yes, he is.
From both sides. I'm glad I come out here. I made a good move when I come out
to
here.
To Vernon, B.C. Well, it's a nice little village, kind of Vernon.
It has
picks apples all summer and eats
Kelowna.
Apples all winter.
Yeah, it's near Kelowna work.
Near Kelowna.
Oh, that's its big claim to fame.
I want to pay you a compliment, Hab. You've sat here and practically not opened your mouth, which is unheard of in the history of the Capozzi family.
Well, as the token Italian in the middle of you two wasps, that's the least I can do.
I've been
enjoying your talking about wins and losses in sports, and the Scots couldn't even win a referendum.
And not only
are you
that,
about to knock my friend Wally Johnston?
Willie Johnston.
Wally.
Willie.
It's not Willie.
It's Wally. That's right.
Wally Johnston.
Well, the only thing I can say about Wally is when I first found out when that song about you belong to Glasgow, I do now, because after what we're paying him, I guess I belong
He's
there.
He's the guy that flunked his urinalysis in the last World Cup.
Yeah, that's true.
Wound up with Coke or whatever guys get in the urinalysis to get pepped up. Benny's, you'd know about Benny's from football.
No, it wasn't even that. It was actually
a cold
oh,
remedy.
Come on. What is this?
Yeah, he was left out in the cold.
It's neosinephrine or some way. Wally Johnston. And you got him here.
Yes.
The new stoned
Wally.
Age. Now you got him here.
That's right.
Dick Beddoes, Hal Capozzi, and my name is Alan Fotheringham.
Alan Fotheringham is a much older man.
Sportsman, raconteur, racquetball player, the lot. 15 seconds to plug your thing for tonight.
Well, you've watched them for free for $200. You can watch them again tonight for the dinner for the Canadian Diabetic Association. If you want tickets, phone 688-2024. with the proceeds going to help the research fund, the Charles Best Research Fund for Insulin.
All in honor of J. Stuart Keith, the retiring publisher of the Vancouver Sun.
Is he the paper retired with him?
It did.
Yes.
The non-published Vancouver Sun. Had 252,000 the day it struck. Be lucky if it has got 175 and it goes back. Linda, tomorrow.
Who will be with us tomorrow?
The Flora.
Yeah.
God bless Flora,
Queen,
my darling.
Queen Flora, she calls herself.
My thanks to Beddoes, Capozzi, and especially to Webster. Tomorrow, 9 a.m. precisely.